Hello everyone. I'm going to tell you about utopia, architecture, and urbanism tonight, and take you to places and experiments from the past centuries that may surprise you. The ambition to imagine and then build an ideal community, or to better society through urbanism, this is a very ancient thing. Greek thinkers already wrote about it, and they tried to figure out how an ideal society should work, and what the place where it would live should be like. Of course, all the choices that are made in architecture or in city planning, they are not aimed at building the perfect society, far from that. But still, even when they have limited ambitions, they always reveal a lot of preferences, a lot of choices, such as how should people live, how should people move, what space is private or public. In fact, the way we build our towns, our cities, even our homes, they all reveal our way of life, our priorities, our values. So societies model their cities. But the question is, can it work the other way around? And could a new model of housing, a new model of architecture, change society, make it happier, more harmonious? And this raises a lot of new questions. Does it work? We will look at plenty of historical experiments. Is it possible? Is it desirable? Who decides for what? Where is the limit between individual liberty and social needs? These are some of the questions we're going to explore in this story. So it's going to be in two parts. In this first part, I will tell you about how cities were planned and how their status evolved since the antiquity. I will also focus on various experiments, various attempts at creating utopian communities, ideal cities, in the 18th and 19th centuries. In the second part, available soon, we will focus on the 20th and the 21st centuries. We will see how all this utopian heritage inspired new forms of housing, how new cities were created in India, in France, in Britain, in Brazil, how new concepts, even though they remained theoretical, like arcologies, were formed. So that gives us a lot to discuss tonight. But don't worry, we're going to take things one by one, and before you know it, we will have traveled across various continents and explored many different concepts. It's all going to be very easy to follow, as long as you let the sound of my voice guide you. You don't need to keep your eyes opened to follow this, so don't hesitate to drift and fall asleep whenever you feel like it. There are timestamps in the first comment to resume the story later, and you can also download this video, or just the audio track, from my Patreon page. There is a link in the description. But for now, just try to let go of the tension in your shoulders and your limbs. Our journey to the past is about to begin. Before we start exploring more ancient times, I'm going to tell you a story that has been a bit forgotten. It's going to be long and take us to America and France, and to the origins of socialism. But it illustrates how utopia and the dream of a new community could create an actual town that lasted for a century. Nowadays, many people would think that the founders of socialism, of socialist thought, are figures like Karl Marx or Friedrich Engels. These are major figures in the history of ideas, but the appearance of socialism is older than them, and long before Marx published his theories and later inspired communist revolutions, there had been critical thinkers trying to invent a new model of society that would free the working class and improve its situation. When the Marxist approach to socialism emerged, it quickly marginalized other currents of thought in the socialist family, maybe because it was more attractive, more appealing. It is very broad and systematic. It explains mechanisms that people had sometimes not even been aware of beforehand. It makes sense of history and the way the society functions. It gives a status to the working class by putting social classes and their struggle at the center of its analysis. We have to realize that for people from this new industrial working class in the first half of the 19th century, apart from difficult living conditions, there was an identity problem. They had no trade unions yet, no political parties representing them. Actually, working class was not even a term in this period, and Marx gave them a role to play, a value, and showed a way, a path towards a better society for them. All of this gave Marxism a huge appeal for both intellectuals, because it was big on theorizing, and this new industrial working class that was quickly growing. So that in the 20th century, Marxism completely marginalized, it almost erased other approaches to socialist thought, very often with the help of the Marxists themselves. They attacked any competing view because they had little doubt that they were in the right. But several decades before Marx became a famous public figure, there were already socialist thinkers who were trying to reform or revolutionize society with a different angle. You've probably heard of anarchists. This current is fairly marginal, but it still exists. And anarchism is older than Marxism. It received a lot of different influences, but its founding father was a French politician called Pierre-Joseph Proudhon. He was a very subversive figure. He's the one who coined the phrase, "property is theft." This is how radical he was, and his ideas were seen with horror by the conservatives and wealthier classes in France. But even before Proudhon and anarchism, there had been several thinkers from the 18th and early 19th century called utopian socialists. They didn't call themselves utopian. It is a label put on their work later, especially by other socialists, on the grounds that their proposals were naive or not grounded in the reality of the existing society, which made them supposedly useless. And it is true that the thought of utopian socialists was way less revolutionary and threatening for society as it was. They didn't believe in class struggle or in the need for a revolution, for socialism to emerge. They thought people of all classes could spontaneously abandon their old positions and join their plans, because they would offer a new model of harmony, cooperation, and prosperity that in itself could be sufficient to attract everyone. Instead of focusing on grand plans to take control of the state or put upside down the basis of society, they were more interested in inventing plans for the organization of a new society. And these plans could be experimented with small communities to demonstrate the feasibility of their social model. These utopian socialists were represented in various countries. In the UK, there was a Welsh textile manufacturer called Robert Owen. He inspired the creation of communities in the United States, where he lived for a few years, and he participated in the movement that created cooperatives and trade unions. There were several in America, too. And another prominent figure in France was a man called Charles Fourier. He also inspired the creation of utopian communities in the 19th century, and some of his views that were seen as really radical at the beginning of the 19th century have actually become mainstream today. For example, he is credited for the creation of the term feminism. So, what was Fourier's vision? He believed that the key to a successful, prosperous, happy and fair society was cooperation between people, and that everything should be made to promote this cooperation. He envisioned communities of a few hundred persons that he called phalanxes, and he imagined that these communities would live in structures, apartment complexes, where the richest had the uppermost apartments and the poorest lived on the ground floor. So he was not willing to abolish social classes or inequality of income. He thought they were natural. But someone's wealth would have depended only on their job, and this job would depend on supply and demand. If everyone wants the same job, it comes with a lower pay, and the jobs that have little candidates would pay more, so that in the end everyone ends up with a satisfactory position. Either they prioritize their inclination for a job or the pay, but they would get a good deal. And to ensure that no one gets bored and that work is pleasurable, the job market would be rebooted very often, even every day, so that people would have a chance to change tasks, meet new faces in the community, and not get stuck in something they dislike. The whole point was to try and turn work into pleasure. Around these principles, he elaborated an incredibly complex system. Based on different passions and personalities, he described 810 types of character. And with one of each gender in every phalanx, the ideal community size would have been 1,620 individuals. He tried to anticipate everything, from the need to have some people perform sex work for the sexually rejected, to a minimal guaranteed income for people who couldn't work. And he believed or hoped that this organization would put people in a constant state of satisfaction. They would be stimulated intellectually, emotionally, physically, and that would keep them happy and the community harmonious. Few people took this seriously, and it's true that a lot of objections can be raised. At the very least, it places a lot of faith in everyone's willingness to participate in the community, without trying to take advantage of it, to gain more than their share. It also needs no animosity between people. It disregards individual ambition, appetite for power. So in a sense, it is based on a very optimistic view of human beings. the idea that they are naturally benevolent and prone to cooperate. And there was also a paradox that we will see in every single example of these utopias. It is supposed to free people, and their participation is voluntary. But at the same time, the system is very prescriptive, very normative. The place where you live, the way you find or change job, your time management, it's all predetermined, and it ends up looking almost carceral. But despite all these limitations, Fourier found his enthusiasts, and his model of the phalanx inspired real communities. Not the exact model that he had envisioned, because they never had the ideal number of 1,620 participants. But various communities tried to replicate it as much as possible. This is how 30 different communities were founded in the United States in the 19th century, with Fourier as their inspiration. I'm going to tell you about three of them: Utopia, Ohio; La Réunion, near Dallas, Texas; and the North American Phalanx in New Jersey. Utopia nowadays is almost a ghost town, but from 1844 it was populated with a community of American citizens trying to create their own utopian society. They attracted more families by offering them a house and a parcel of land against a fee. The land was owned by a sect that believed they had to live in community to achieve enlightenment. But in 1847, 3 years after the creation of this community, the first attempt was ended by a flood of the Ohio River, and many members died in the flood. The settlement was reorganized with an original economic system. It was based upon private property and a market economy, but the basis of exchange value was labor time. Goods and services were traded against labor notes, so that anyone able to work could print their own money in the limit of their time. The settlement grew up to about 40 buildings, including 2 time stores, where working time could be traded. The peak of this experience was in the mid-1850s, because afterwards the impact of the Civil War and the small size of the community led to its decline. Another example is the community of La Réunion, created in 1855, just when Utopia was starting to nosedive. La Réunion was near Dallas, Texas, and it was created by French, Swiss, and Belgian colonists. They were also inspired by Fourierism. The system worked as a cooperative. People could own property individually, but production was for the entire community, and its profits were to be shared between members. There were 400 participants, and they were skilled workers, specialized in weaving, brewing, or watchmaking. This community project was the victim of terrible planning. There was no market locally for their skills, and they were not farmers, so they were quite bad at producing their own food. After only 18 months, due to this poor initial planning, the community was already insolvent, and it was disbanded. But there is one that did better and lasted longer in America, 13 years, the North American Phalanx in New Jersey. Once again, they were all disciples of Fourier, and one of the leaders of this community was a writer, Albert Brisbane, who who published articles about Fourier in New York newspapers. He did a lot to inspire the various communities that started in the 1840s in America. A subscription was started to fund the purchase of land and the construction of a phalanx. This initial subscription was not very successful, and almost no capital remained for the construction of buildings and the purchase of equipment. But the community attracted 20 families, and it eventually reached 100 to 150 people. The organization of labor was not exactly like Fourier had prescribed, but inspired by it. There were different departments: agriculture, livestock, manufacturing, education, and so on. And in each of these departments, smaller groups of 3 to 7 people who worked cooperatively on specific tasks. People got paid by the hour, with a premium for less appealing tasks and a penalty on lighter and more attractive jobs. And people were constantly voting. Each group voted for its representant. The group's representatives voted for a chief of department, and the chiefs of department for the head of the colony. But they also appraised their co-workers, and other bonuses and penalties could be applied to wages, depending on each person's appraisal. The system was intended to promote good behavior, but you can easily see the downside too. Everyone was under constant scrutiny and appraisal by others. But it seems the community had a fairly good social atmosphere though, and this lasted 4 years. There were concerts, plays, dances organized by the entertainment department. People socialized out of working hours. They walked together in the woods. They played cards. They sang. And they also received a lot of visitors, either family members or just curious people, people who wanted to see what the experience looked like. Visitors often told that the atmosphere was that of like an ideal New England village. But ultimately, even though this experience lasted for several years, it declined because the participants started to lose faith in it. A lot had been promised, especially social transformation and economic abundance. They had transformation somehow, but it ended looking more like a friendly group of neighbors than a brand new society. An economic abundance there wasn't at all. The community was not that productive, and because the initial funding was very scarce, it had to reimburse the mortgage contracted to buy the land. Another critique was the hyper-democratic nature of the system. People were constantly voting and planning their work shifts, legislating about the community, which ultimately drained their energy. This is a criticism often directed at political movements too, especially on the far left. They require so much energy to sustain themselves and their constant consultation of the basis of the grassroots that their energy gets lost. They cannot grow above a few dozen participants, and they tend to fracture in multiple factions every time there is a disagreement, because their day-to-day reality becomes a constant conversation about how they should function. Despite this problem, the community continued until 1854, when there was a disastrous fire that destroyed the colony's mill. The group was crippled with debt, and this led to its dissolution in 1856. So the North American Phalanx was the last of these 30 different Fourierist experiments in the US. But even though none of them was actually successful, the biggest experiment was yet to come, and this time in France. In 1859 started the construction of the Familistère, an entire town created by an idealistic French industrialist for his employees and their families. The founder of this community was a man called Jean-Baptiste Gaudin. He started with a small workshop, and like many others during the Industrial Revolution, his business grew. He produced stoves, and he became one of the main manufacturers in this sector in France, with 1,500 employees. They all worked in his factory of Guise, a small town north of Paris. But he had begun as a worker himself in his father's workshop, and he remembered very well how harsh the work and life conditions were for industrial workers. He also discovered Fourier's writings, and he decided to get involved in attempts to make them become reality. He funded a big part of the community of La Réunion, the one created in Texas in the 1840s that I just talked about. He lost a third of his fortune in this adventure, but he recovered and kept trying. What he really wanted, and that inspired his community, was to offer an alternative to the capitalist industrial society that was emerging. And he wanted to offer workers the kind of material comfort and liberty that only the bourgeois class could enjoy. Starting in 1859, he began to build his community around the factory. And later he transformed the company into a cooperative business whose profits would fund the schools, social security, and different services for all people working in it. He did not copy Fourier's model because he was well aware of the difficulty to replicate it in the real world, but he did take a lot of elements from it. He rejected individual housing and went for a communitarian model because he believed that pooling resources in common and sharing amenities would offer his workers the equivalent of wealth. They would live in large buildings resembling palaces. Actually, he called this project the Social Palace. They would be able to access services for young children, freeing women from domestic work. They would have a school, a theater, a library, bath, a swimming pool. In other words, cooperation would allow all the members access to luxuries that only the rich could dream of at the time. Gaudin also created a social security system for the employees and their families. This provided insurance against accidents, against disease, a pension when they would retire. In this field, he was not the first. By the middle of the 19th century, there had already been such systems created in Britain, either by capitalists or by associations of workers. People who lived in this social palace discovered an architecture designed to serve these ideals. All apartments were accessible from a courtyard that was very luminous with a glass ceiling. Apartments had water, bathrooms, and heating. For the time in the 1850s, that was a luxury. There were cultural events, plays, shows, and school was compulsory until 14 years old. That was really progressive for the time. In France in the 1850s, children could legally start to work at 10. It was not well seen, but it existed. This social palace really did improve people's living conditions, but at the same time it didn't go without critics. First there was a critique from the socialists, who argued that this couldn't be a solution for the society at large, because it all depended on the goodwill of the company's owner. And it is a fact that Godin was an exception, not the norm. Another critique revolved around paternalism. And it is true that this experience is a magnified form of paternalism. What does it mean? When the Industrial Revolution began, a new working class, mainly coming from the countryside, appeared, and it grew very quickly. In Britain, it even became bigger than the farmers' class. There was an urgent need for housing, to give these people a place to live, and also to attract more of them. So, around factories and mines, industrial companies built entire cities for workers, generally long lines of individual houses. And because these new industrial towns were sometimes far from the cities and the farms, these companies also provided shops, they built churches, schools, so that the families could spend almost their entire life there. There were certainly good intentions behind this, but also a calculation. Industrial workers ended depending entirely on their employers, not only for work, but for every aspect of their lives. And this guaranteed they couldn't go. They couldn't revolt against working conditions. They could not even easily ask for raises. The creation of trade unions, mutualism, the adoption of socialist theories in this group were also a reaction to its complete weakness in front of their employers. Some of the employers were absolutely sincere in their wish to improve the condition of the working class, but still, by providing everything they thought they needed, they forced their own vision of what a good worker should be, and they eliminated a large part of their freedom. That's paternalism, and Godin falls into that category to some extent. He had already predefined what a good life had to be for his employees. He wished them well, but not outside the path that he had defined. And he was absolutely committed to them. When he died, all his possessions went to the community. But he was a paternalist. For example, he was an atheist, and there could be no church built near the social palace. The architecture of apartments with windows looking at the inner courtyard made it possible to watch inside each home. Inhabitants had no right to put curtains. This was intended to put a friendly pressure on everyone so that they would maintain their apartment well and behave correctly when at home. But nowadays this kind of architecture where everything is visible and there can be no privacy is used for prisons. It's quite telling. But still, people who could live inside the social palace were privileged among the working class, and they grew attached to their community. Economically, this entire community was dependent on the factory, and the factory did well until long after Godin's death in 1888. The stoves it produced remained among the first on the market until the 1960s. And the social palace remained inhabited all this time. But bit by bit, the original system with its cooperative spirit lost ground. People no longer wanted to pay for the common services they didn't use. White collars started to leave the social palace to buy individual houses. And in 1968, the factory was sold, and the apartments became private. They were sold to their occupants, like in a condominium. At this time, after a century, Gaudin's Fourierist experiment ended. The complex of buildings, called the Familistère, can be partly visited nowadays. There are still people living in the social palace, but it is no longer an utopian community, just a condominium. So that was a long story to begin with, but I think it illustrates how imagining a different society, or trying to improve the one we have, cannot be dissociated from urbanism and architecture. And this realization appeared long before the 19th century. So let's go back to the time machine for now and explore more ancient times. Most actual human communities are spontaneous. They appeared somewhere as a small settlement and they developed organically, progressively, depending on the needs. They are the product of multiple decisions. Sometimes they can be rebuilt and modified, but their existence precedes this. An ideal city or community is a project conceptualized and elaborated before it is built, and that is a major difference. Whatever its vision and principles, an ideal city is based on a model, a system, that is supposed to bring harmony or a new social organization considered desirable. The dream of erecting an ideal city is very ancient, and there are traces of it in the antiquity, for example in the myth of the Tower of Babel. What the story of this myth says is that the human race was unified and formed one single people after the Great Flood, and they spoke a single language. Humans agreed to build a city and a tower tall enough to reach heaven, but God took that as an offense, so he confounded their speech. They could no longer understand each other, and they scattered around the world. There are similar myths in Sumerian and Assyrian traditions that are even older. Actually, the vast majority of biblical scholars consider the Tower of Babel as an origin myth, not a factual account. But apart from the cautionary tale, "Do not defy God," it also reveals an aspiration to build something perfect, to elevate the human community towards perfection or even a godlike status through the building, the creation of a city. The ancient Greeks devoted a lot of attention to their social and political organization. They questioned its basis, how it worked, how it could be reformed, improved. You probably heard about the Republic by Greek philosopher Plato. It is his best known work, written as a dialogue, and in this work he exposes ideas about justice and what a just and orderly city-state should be like. The Republic is just a famous example, but the Greeks produced a lot of descriptions and recommendations about what a political community and the city it lived in could be and how it could improve and function harmoniously. And as they were big city creators, because their city-states sponsored colonies all around the Mediterranean Sea, they tried to bring some of their views to their new cities. In the 7th century BC, this is really the early period of Greek civilization, they introduced the grid plan to several of their new colonies, meaning that their colonies were planned with streets forming right angles. It may sound basic, but it reveals a taste for optimization and planification that were far from obvious in the antiquity. A Greek philosopher, architect, and engineer called Hippodamos pushed for the adoption of the grid plan in the 5th century BC. He is credited for making the plans of Piraeus, the port of Athens. Actually, the grid plan for a city is sometimes called the Hippodamian plan after him. And Hippodamos was praised by Aristotle, who considered his organization of urban space as the physical translation of the ideal republic, clear lines, rational, optimized, egalitarian for citizens. Aristotle also spent a lot of effort theorizing how a rational and harmonious political and social organization should work. The Greeks perceived their cities as places where space had a different status, in particular the difference between public and private space. Of course, it is something that happens in any city. There are homes with an access restricted to their owners and their families and guests, and there are public spaces where everyone can go, streets, squares. But the Greeks also theorized this, and they tried to figure out what should be private, what should be public, and whether every public space should be accessible to everyone. Think about the place where you live. Unless you live in a hamlet or in the middle of nowhere, the space around you has a variety of status and significance that you navigate because you learned these things. There are private properties, and you know they are inaccessible unless you own or rent them, or unless you are invited inside. There are fully public spaces, like streets or parks, where anyone can go. And there are spaces in between. Some may be privately owned, but open to the public, like a commercial center, or a restaurant, a movie theater. Others are also opened to theoretically anyone, but they are designed for a particular community, like a church, for example. There are spaces for the whole community where access is restricted to when you need them, like schools or hospitals. We learn how this urban space works from a young age, and we have a mental map of it on top of the physical map. We know where we are supposed to go or not, and how to behave depending on where we are. This urban geography is not neutral. People create it when they create the place they live, and it reflects their lifestyle and their priorities. But it works both ways. It also pushes you to live a certain way. For example, in a particular town, if the location where people usually gather to socialize is a park or a church or a mall, the implications for the community may be very different. Their cities were certainly simpler and smaller than ours, but the Greeks and then the Romans had understood very well that the city, the urbis, also shaped the communities that lived inside. What people did, what they spent time on, what their values were. so they didn't let cities grow chaotically. And the Romans adopted Greek concepts about what a good city should be. The very center of it, at the intersection of the two main axes, the north-south and the east-west axis, was public space, the city's forum. And the Romans introduced public services like baths, toilets, basilicas. Of course, this was convenient, but not only. It also built a sense of belonging. It contributed to turn inhabitants into citizens. What I'm trying to say here is that city planning and building, to them, was not just utilitarian. Of course, people needed a place to live, but cities were also supposed to reflect the vision of what a good society, a good community, should be. The Greeks and the Romans never tried themselves at social engineering, in the sense that they never tried to invent a brand new kind of community where social interactions would be different. More than anything, they tried to replicate the model of their city of origin, which they saw as the benchmark: Rome, Athens, Sparta, and so on. But even though they were mainly agrarian societies, most people didn't live in cities, actually, they installed this idea that cities are the place where society reaches its best, its perfection. And this vision stayed long after their hour had passed. It survived the Middle Ages, which in Europe was a time when relatively few new cities were created. But in the 7th, 8th, 9th centuries, the one civilization that was expanding and flourishing culturally was Islam. It built on a rich heritage from more ancient civilizations, especially the Greeks and the Romans. And the new Muslim states were major city creators. Maybe the most significant city founded in the entire world in this period was Baghdad. And at the start, it was founded with a very ambitious vision, a model of harmony, spirituality, and aesthetics. The city was founded in the 8th century to become the new capital of the Abbasids, a dynasty that came to control most of the Middle East. It would have been built in just 4 years by 100,000 workers following a carefully established plan. The city was perfectly round. Its diameters would have been about 1.5 miles. That is not very large, but still respectable for a city of the first millennium. It was entirely circled by a wide ditch and two circular walls with 4 doors and 112 towers. The center was occupied by the palace, the mosque, and the barracks. So basically the various figures of power, political, religious, military. And the city itself was a thick ring between the center and the walls. The creation of this city is a good example of an attempt at creating the perfect city, a model of balance, convenience, protection, too, that was worthy of the powerful caliphate. But Baghdad didn't keep this shape long, because it was victim of its success. In just a few years, it had outgrown its limits, and it became one of the biggest and most influential cities in the Middle East, until it fell into the hands of the Mongols in the 13th century, several centuries after the creation of the city. So, as you see, urban planning is not a new thing. It existed for several thousand years. But it started to take another dimension in the 15th century. Until this period, there had been plenty of attempts and a attention paid to the creation of better, even perfect cities. But cities had not been seen as a tool to change society, to modify its bases. Quite the opposite, actually. Ancient civilizations, when they founded a new city, tried to use it as a tool to reinforce the model of their society as it was, to enforce it. The concept that urbanism and cities could be a tool to change society, to improve it, arrived with the Renaissance and utopias. Europe in general was strongly influenced by the Renaissance movement that started in Italy in the 15th century. It was not a sudden break from the Middle Ages, but rather the progressive spread of various discoveries, technical like the printing press, geographical, medical, scientific, new political concepts too, a rediscovery of the heritage from the antiquity. Another aspect was an intense thinking about politics and urbanism. All the more that Italy was dominated by city-states, and this meant that, to them, the ideal society and the ideal city were almost the same thing. Antique cities taken as a model, especially Rome, had larger avenues, grand perspectives, and this contrasted with medieval cities that had small, narrow streets and no rational grid. At the same time, in the 15th, 16th, 17th centuries, a new genre of literature appeared around this concern of what the ideal society should be. This happened in various countries. In England, there was Thomas More, the author of Utopia, the description of a perfect society living on an island. And later, Francis Bacon. He published a book called The New Atlantis, which also describes an utopian society. In France, there was Rabelais. In Italy, there was Tommaso Campanella. He wrote The City of the Sun in 1602, in which he describes an ideal city, both politically and urbanistically. His city reflects the social, economic, and political organization of the society he envisioned. Relatively few real cities were built based on all these ideas, but there were some, such as the city of Pienza in Italy, or Palmanova in 1593, a city built on the territory of Venice in the shape of a star with nine branches. Palmanova was a fortress city, and the shape was for military reasons. There were bastions that could cover each other, and it was very influential in the design of fortresses in the 17th and 18th centuries. There were no more high walls because of the progress in artillery, but rather low star-shaped structures that left no angle unprotected. Beyond its defensive features, Palmanova is also inspired by the quest for beauty and rationality. In France, there was the town of Richelieu, founded by the cardinal of the same name, the one that appears as a villain of fiction in The Three Musketeers. And in the New World, cities were founded with the same ambition to turn them into models of harmony for a better society. An example of that is Philadelphia. In 1681. It has a grid plan. It is the oldest grid plan in the US, with large avenues and parks in the initial plan. And this worked hand in hand with the quest for urban harmony, There were laws like the guarantee of the freedom of religion, or the abolition of the death penalty for theft, and these were supposed to make it more human. In South America too, the Spanish and the Portuguese created many new cities with a great plan and a model that was convenient, but also the product of all this thinking about good urbanism. Around the central square were all the various aspects of authority, church, town hall, barracks, with public services, so that urban life and the acceptance of the rule of law were merged into the same thing. In the 18th century, the multiplication of philosophers questioning society and politics as a part of the Enlightenment movement only stimulated more this thinking process around the establishment of the ideal city, the ideal community, and what its environment should be. The utopian socialists we discussed at the beginning built on this heritage from the Enlightenment. An example of an 18th century ideal city is the Rayol salt works of Arc-et-Senans in the east of France. It was not entirely built because the initial project was more ambitious, but like in the case of Gaudin and his social palace, it was a city project built around a production facility. The soils in this region of eastern France are rich in salt, and salt was a more valuable commodity in the past than it is today. It was used to preserve food before refrigeration and canning replaced it, and it was a major source of tax for the state. The salt works were designed to produce salt by boiling brine and water. The architect, Claude-Nicolas Ledoux, proposed a model in which all buildings and the distances between them were optimized, and their organization would reflect the hierarchy and order of the place. At the center of the facility was the house of the director, from which the entire city was visible, and around it, on either side of the director's house, the salt works themselves. They contained drying ovens and salt stores. There were also buildings forming a half circle that were the quarters for all the workers, laborers, carpenters, coopers. And at each intersection of the circle and the diameter, buildings for the clerks. The entire building is inspired by geometry, symmetry, and a preoccupation for balance and aesthetics, but there is more to it. It is also the transcription, in stone, of the social order and productivity that was expected from the facility. Production units are symbolically central. Authority is at the very center, and nothing can escape its watch. Optimization is key, with the least possible distance between the various steps of the production process. Like in Gaudin's social palace, this architecture reminds of prisons in a sense. And that's always the paradox. When an utopian social system is imagined, it is very hard to not make it look like a carceral system, because it is highly normative, and it expects individuals to behave in a certain way. Then started the 19th century and the experiments we discussed before, Robert Owen or Charles Fourier. But with the Industrial Revolution, the tremendous growth of cities and the new needs like transportation, the 19th century was also one of intense reorganization of existing cities. London, Paris, New York City, Berlin, they all became metropolis of several million inhabitants, and this implied an expansion and sometimes a reorganization. A good example of that is Paris, the face of Paris, and its sense of unity nowadays come from the very heavy rebuilding that took place in the 19th century. There are still older buildings and small streets here and there, but overall, the center of Paris reflects the vision for a modern city in the 19th century. Large avenues connecting the train stations, perspectives with monuments, more space like parks to breathe, as opposed to the very dense medieval city. Similar plans existed for London, actually, but the difference was that France was under an authoritarian regime, the Second Empire, in the 1850s and 60s, and the regime was able to impose the expropriations and years of never-ending reorganizations inside the city. This proved politically impossible in London, which also changed face a lot in the 19th century, but its plan was not modified as much. All these centuries of thinking about architecture and cities, the growth and sometimes the radical changes to cities in the 19th century with the Industrial Revolution, their growing importance in terms of demography and for the economy. All this ended producing the notion of urbanism, which actually is from the late 19th century. The term was not in use before. And with this notion of urbanism came a much more analytical vision of what a city is. There was a theorization of its functions. By functions, urbanists mean housing, production, trade, sometimes transport. This is key to understand urbanism nowadays and city building in the 20th century, because they are entirely based on answers to the questions raised by these new industrial cities. Questions like, should the various functions, residential, productive, commercial, be separated or mixed together in the same space? How will people move inside or outside of the city? How is it connected to other cities? Should social classes be mixed and live together or remain separated? A large part of urbanism revolves around these questions. And modern post-industrial cities have become tremendously different from the model of cities that dominated for centuries. I'll come back to that in the second part, but just to give you an example or an idea about it, imagine you have to walk from one city to another, to enter a city by foot. It has become almost impossible. Cities are very well connected by highways, railroads, or planes. But if you want to walk, like our ancestors did, there is no access for you. You have to cross fields, to follow railroads, to walk through industrial zones. Contemporary cities are very well connected between them, but they are also very cut from their immediate environment. But we will come back to this when we explore all this 20th and 21st century urbanism and the ongoing quest for the ideal city in the second part of this story. For now, we have reached the end of the first part, and you can now let go and fall asleep if you're still with me. I'll talk to you soon for more discoveries. In the meantime, thank you for listening. Au revoir.